prophetic meaning to our lives, and that's what we want to share with people in the future. That path to enlightenment is an extraordinary, valuable thing to be able to preserve. Cause of suffering, cause of happiness, understanding that. I mean, it's the basic fundamental thing that every sentient being is involved in every second of the day, motivated, looking for happiness, not wanting suffering. They can't figure out why they still continue to suffer in some form or another, because there's no real valid method. So we've been given the method, and now we need to preserve it into the future, and we can do that, I think, if we work together. So around, I think, 1984, that time the issue passed away. For a lot of the older students, it was quite a shock because Lama passed away. What's going to happen now? What can we do now? What should we do now? And I don't know exactly what older students thought at that time. I know what I thought, but I'm not going to tell you. So the first thing, of course, some of the older students at that time looked to Rinpoche, obviously, and then Rinpoche said no, he didn't want to. They thought, he didn't think he was the person to do this, and he started thinking of other people to give the organization to. But in the end, I think Nick Rebush, who's the director of Lama Yeshe Wisdom Archive, who's been around for a long time, he requested Rinpoche to please accept responsibility for the organization and take over from Lama Yeshe. So I think Rinpoche kind of accepted. Then what Rinpoche started to do was he started to travel to centers. I think, I can't say for sure, but from where I was sitting or standing, I think Rinpoche had to, he wanted to, for students of the, at that time, he wanted to show students that, you know, Lama Yeshe's wishes, what he was doing could continue. It could, you know, to give them faith and strength to continue what he wasn't able to continue. So, from my perspective, how Rinpoche did that was he went on the road. He became a roadie. It wasn't music, it was Dharma. And basically he went non-stop from center to center for the next 15, 20 years. And it was 7 days a week. Basically 24 hours a day. And there was no night, there was no day. He just kept going. I mean, like, just, you know, you just went from airport to airport, straight to the center, back to the airport, to the next city, airport to the center, back to the airport, next city. And that was day and night, 7 days a week. And I think around 10 or 12 years of that, and then I said, oh, I was saying to Rinpoche, don't, you know, what about a break? Yeah, I can honestly say at that time, I never even heard Rinpoche say, let's stop for a cup of tea. That never ever came from his side. You would have to offer the tea. You know, it would, even that much never came from his side. So Rinpoche would screw his face up when I would talk about a break or have a holiday or one day off or something like that. I thought it was, seemed to be sort of a disgusting idea. And so one day I got really, really frustrated. Well, it wasn't for one day. And I just asked Rinpoche, I said, well, Rinpoche, what's your definition of rest? I couldn't figure it out. And Rinpoche said, abiding in virtue. That was Rinpoche. And then I thought, then it sort of naturally came on my eyes. I sort of accepted, because then I thought, oh, that's a bodhisattva's way of life. You know, and then for some reason I sort of, it became easier for me in one sense, except that, yeah, this is Rinpoche's life. This is what he does. You know, he can't think of doing something different or not being of benefit. That just, there is no thought like that existing.
See, everybody in the world is able to live their life without discriminating thought, without the discriminating anger and attachment. You can imagine what a peace, what a great peace, what a happiness, what a great peace, happiness, everyone. People, well, all the problems that global problems, individual problems, come from those problems. Good. Well, isn't it? Ciò controlla, vedi, ciò controlla, non de, cosa? By plants, by vegetable, yes, teacher by vegetable. Yeah. Okay. Their numbers not counted. Yeah. Or number this. Or kill every hour in the world. So, like Syria, or like those many countries, like those Muslim countries, that. This done by the mind, all the wars, all this bombing. All these innocent people, good people get killed, so many, where? So this violence, is created by the mind, which does not fall. No color, no shapes, no untouchable. But what it can do, if it's not subdued, if it's not subdued, you're not happy. Even you are retreating, even you are in an isolation place, but even not taking care of your mind, you're not doing really cheap. Even though you are isolation place, isolated place, but not really catching down, not really changing your mind. Your mom or your mind, let go under the attachment, you know, the anger, so what, you know, not really cheating. Yeah, not becoming Dharma, not living in Dharma. So even yourself is not happy. You touch yourself. You touch yourself. You know, your mind brings problem. Not touching down. Not thinking your mind brings problem to yourself. Nobody brings problem, but yourself brings problem to yourself. Like that, you know. Then the delusion attachment becomes stronger than sometimes even thought of suicidal times. In general, mind is something as untouchable, they can't see, can't touch, you know, but so it is not subdued, so dangerous. So the global problem and the country problem, society problem, family problem, and the individual problem. Nothing bad on the mind. That the responsibility that we have. it's one last. That basis of practice of Buddhism. But also that part, like I mentioned, the examining facts. So that, I think that's very good. Because otherwise, otherwise it's just collecting in the computer information, like that. Collecting information in the computer, we learn, but just want to learn, but not actualizing. That's the problem. So, of course, one must practice as much as possible, but in the daily delivery, as much as possible, of course. Yeah. So fortunate. So, So anyway, so without that, you know, without studying that, then studying that, you know, without that, learning, you know, like storing the computer, then Buddhism in the West is not much. Buddhism, India, Tibet, so many holy places, Tibet, Nepal, so many holy places like the ancient realization. You know, places. So, otherwise, Buddhism in the West becomes like it was approved. When you put somebody on the river, somebody doesn't look down, somebody sits on the river. You know, on the water, so to get, you know, in the brain, the shallow is great. So there's danger. There was a question about Buddhism in the West, and it comes to that things, hundred things, in the West, it's see things more like shallow, and she was sitting like that. So, anyway, how you are? So it doesn't become like that. So also in meditation, then it's very good. Then really, then also can become like Tibet or like Nepal, India. So the great benefit, the deep benefit of Buddhism, very deep benefit. Otherwise, it's just passing information. Just like that. So, something good. Yeah, let's go.